The History of Clothing, Part 2.
Polski strój narodowy.
Polish attire for men, as we've mentioned, at the end of the 16th century, took the initial forms of a kaftan. Here we see the sleeves of this cloak, made of patterned cloth, and the elegant covering, the delia. The delia had a large fur collar, long split sleeves that hung to the ground, and in its earlier forms, as seen here, were fitted at the waist and flared at the bottom. It was fastened only here at the top with a row of metal buttons. This form of the delia was also affected by fashion and underwent changes. Nicholas Ray described the changeability of Poles in this regard. The long delia is beautiful, as one looks so stately in the saddle, and the short one is marvelous, because it is comfortable. Large collars had their advantages, as did small ones. During its first period, Polish attire was quite varied in terms of form of its basic elements. Less than magnificent coats were also worn. Here we have two very interesting portraits showing a biekiesza, a type of outer garment lined with fur and fastened with loops, a very characteristic element of Polish garments that appeared in the 15th century thanks to the influence from the East. The bekiesza was fastened with ribbons, and it was these fasteners that came to Poland from the East, and through Hungary as well. They became an identifying feature of Polish garb.
Stały się rozpoznawalnym znakiem polskiego ubioru. Znamy na przykład portrety Elżbiety.
There are portraits of Queen Elizabeth of England in a dress with such fasteners. The dress is said to be in a Polish style.
Jest też koszula.
Interesting also is the shirt worn with Polish attire, as it was cut differently than Western shirts, which had decorative trim at the neck. However, the Polish shirt had a very narrow collar, which was barely visible above the top edge of the kaftan and often fastened with a decorative round pin. Because not much of the shirt was visible, some reports by Western observers noted that Poles didn't wear shirts at all. But that isn't true. The closets of the nobility were well stocked with shirts. Another covering worn by a noble was a kireja, which, unlike the delia, did not have a large fur collar. A characteristic element of Polish attire was a cap like this, with its fur band. Here we see one other interesting detail. When we think of this splendid silk sash, a magnificent element of Polish attire, we associate it with the waistband worn with the robe. However, the custom of tying a silk sash around the waist began with the kaftan. Here we see the kaftan with the sash. Under this silk sash is a metal belt, to which the sword sheath was fastened.
Do którego na rapciach przyczepiona jest pochwa na szablę. Rozmaitość strojów noszonych.
The variety of dress worn in Poland during this period is also seen in this portrait from the early 17th century, showing a man dressed in the style of Western Europe in the Renaissance.
Europejskiej mody renesansowej. I tutaj widzimy.
Here we see its characteristic features, for example, that it accented the broad chest, a sense of being sure of oneself, the massiveness of the man.
Masywność postaci. Okrycie, które ma tu narzucone.
The overcoat worn here by Jerzy Mniszek is called a czamara.
Tak zwana czamara.
That name will return to Polish fashion in the 18th and 19th centuries, but will have nothing in common with this Renaissance overcoat. Gloves held in the hand were a symbol of high social status. Gloves appeared in the 16th century as a fashionable accessory, thanks to the influence of the elegant Italian court. At the turn of the 16th century, both domestic and Western dress coexisted in Poland. The choice of garments was an expression of what one liked, as well as political affiliation. This beautiful medal, worn by Jerzy Mniszek, shows the image of King Sigismund III, who was known for not wearing Polish garb, but for favoring Western dress, even in his everyday attire. Initially, Polish dress in its ceremonial version consisted of the kaftan and the delia. But in the 1630s, another covering appeared that replaced it, and the robe became the symbol of Polish national ceremonial attire. Like the kaftan, the robe came to Poland from the East, but was modified by Poles in accordance with the achievements and skills of Western tailoring. A characteristic feature of this robe, though not from the very beginning, was the split sleeves. The robe could be worn with the arms in the sleeves, or the sleeves could be tossed back. What the wearer did with the sleeves of the robe was an expression of his attitude towards a given situation. As during ceremonial occasions, sleeves were not worn on the arms, but over the shoulder. And so we see Kazimierz Ossoliński standing here in this representative ceremonial portrait with his sleeves tossed behind him. We can see the lining of the sleeve opening in the same color as that of the kaftan worn underneath. Because the robe, unlike the delia, had no openings on the side which allowed access to a weapon, the metal belt with its attached sword, as well as the cloth waistband, started to be worn on the outside of the robe, and thus the robe sash appeared. What is interesting is that the robe, like Western dress, was worn with the right flap covering the left, unlike modern male garments, but like those for women. The magnificence of old Polish garments amazed observers at court ceremonies in the Old Republic, as well as the magnificent entrances made by Polish deputies sent to foreign capitals. The most famous event of this type was the ceremonial arrival of Jerzy Ossoliński, sent as a legate to Pope Urban by King Władysław IV. The legend of this magnificent entrance made centuries ago was presented not only in writings and pictures of the period, but also over 100 years later by Canaletto in his magnificent painting, Jerzy Ossoliński Entering Rome. The beautiful scenery is actually Anachronus, because the churches on the square of Santa Maria del Popolo were not yet standing when Ossolinski arrived in Rome. The legend of this entrance underscored the magnificence of not only the dress, but also of how the horses were equipped. Canaletto showed Ossolinski's steed as having gold horseshoes, which he lost to the great joy of onlookers.
Złote podkowy i te podkowy gubił ku radości gawiedzi. W tym czasie modne były maskarady.
In those days, masquerade balls were very popular. And we know that during such balls, people often dressed as characters from various exotic countries and continents of the East. It was often reported that some appeared to be dressed in Turkish or Polish dress. So Polish attire was associated with clothing from the Orient and not from Western Europe. It was in the 18th century that we see that fashion was torn between two contradictory, competing impulses. One was the fashion of the court, with hoops, the wide supports worn underneath dresses, and towering hairstyles and stiff corsets. The other was the fashion for comfortable outfits, informal, domestic, and private. This does not mean they were not elegantly furnished, that the lady of the house got out of bed and threw on a housecoat to greet guests. No, she took great pains when putting on this dressing gown. When we look at Mrs. Branicka, her morning dress is made of thin, white cotton material, which was very expensive then, as costly as French silk. It has all the fashionable details. The center of the décolletage was filled with bows made of silk ribbons, known as
échelle.
She's wearing a band around her neck, called a collaret or binda. She has pearl bracelets, worn in pairs, as was fashionable at the time. Underneath, we see she is not wearing any hoops. There is no such support. She is seated, and we can see her knees outlined underneath her supple dress. Most likely, she is not wearing the very stiff 18th century gorset, only a softer, smaller gorset or brassiere. She is sitting here in a park, presented in an elegant, yet intimate manner. This was attire that was appropriate for greeting guests in the morning. It was only when one left the house that one changed into something like this, known as half-dress. And the most formal was dress. So we have these three degrees of formality: informal, half-dress, and dress. Here we see an example of what one wore when going out during the day, the second degree of formality, the half-dress. In the male version, inspired by the style of the English gentleman. So the daytime attire of an elegant man was dress suited for horseback riding. One was seen in high leather boots, a high-cut wool tailcoat designed for horseback riding. The shape and cut of this suit tells us that it is for horseback riding, though not on roads or the backwoods of one's estate, but for riding a horse in the city. It has a bit more formal style than coats with rounded flaps, which were worn in the most unofficial hours, morning rides on your private property, for example. It's interesting to consider also that this was the brief period where men's trousers could be very tight and display the gentleman's qualities. In this portrait, we see a turning gesture made using the whole body. And this is a result of the nature of the clothing. It only appears to be completely loose and comfortable. Suspenders worn under the vest were not made of elastic, but of metal springs. which ensured they were tight. They exerted a painful pressure on the shoulders. And the neck, in accordance with the demands of elegant fashion, was wrapped in a white scarf, a cravat, tied with apparent nonchalance, though requiring considerable skill to tie properly. So he is wrapped very high with this neckerchief, almost to his ears. So just imagine, here is pressure on the shoulders, a collar and cravat coming up nearly to the ears. So a turning gesture is done with the whole body, because it was difficult to move only the head. Over the course of the 19th century, the tailcoat slowly became the dress reserved for very ceremonial occasions. This is a process observed in relation to various articles of clothing, one which continues today. That which begins as an informal article of clothing steadily becomes acceptable for ever more formal occasions. That's what happened to the tailcoat, which initially was a basic item of a man's wardrobe, but from the middle of the 18th century became limited to being worn only in the evening and in its most ceremonial version. Few people know that the suit, when it appeared around the mid-19th century, was like today's jeans. It was an attire that a man dared put on only in the countryside or at home. However, in time, it became acceptable to wear it in the city, and shortly thereafter, when doing business.
W normalnych okolicznościach biznesowych, jeżeli można tak powiedzieć. Także negliżowy strój męski.
Also men's informal dress, compared to the tailcoat, was not cut in the front, but had rounded flaps.
Półkoliście, ścięte poły, czyli to, co można było na najbardziej taką nieoficjalną.
So that which you could wear for the most informal morning ride, or wear around the house, in time gave rise to the frock and the jacket. The jacket is that attire worn by older men in striped trousers and top hats. In other words, that which had begun as the most informal dress for men, worn only in very private circumstances, in time became the formal attire for celebrations during daytime. A similar process has occurred with modern jeans. They began as nothing more than work clothes, and yet now there are practically no situations where you cannot get by dressed in jeans. These days, we associate a dressing gown or bathrobe with complete privacy. Only those very close to us may see us in a dressing gown. But it was not always thus. Have you ever considered how many painters did their self-portraits wearing a robe? Even King Stanislaw August Poniatowski, with his hourglass and his dressing gown. Originally, the dressing gown was not underclothes. It was attire that was the first example in European fashion, nearly literally borrowed from the Orient, the Japanese kimono. Dutch and English merchants, who traveled to these distant lands in the 17th century, brought back cloth and such loose clothing, which then began being used by men as clothes to be worn around the house. But not something thrown on a bare body after taking a shower. It was put on after taking off your coat and worn over trousers, shirt and vest, especially when he spent many hours in the quiet of his home engaged in intellectual pursuits. It turned out that composers, writers, and artists often had themselves painted in their dressing gowns, as it marked them as people engaged in intellectual work. In addition, the dressing gown differed from fashionable attire in its timeless quality. It was loose, generally made of beautiful cloth, draped beautifully, and so introduced an element that was both contemporary and timeless, and very striking.